Hello and welcome to ETBFSI.com. My name is Amol Dethe and I'm in conversation with Mr. Dhananjay Sinha from JM Financial. Mr. Sinha, glad to have you.
Thank you very much, Amol, to have me on your show.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Sinha. So to begin with, you know, we have just entered into 2022. We have a lot of resolutions. And at one side, there is a big uncertainty of third wave. Though there are a lot of hiccups and, you know, there are a lot of reports that third wave may not impact on the economy. Badly, it may not turn down the economy completely. But there are some short-term challenges. So What are the things that you see specifically in the BFSI or the whole finance sector or the economy going ahead in 2022?
So I think, I will start with the way how economy is likely to pan out over the key changes that we are looking at as we migrate into 2022 and 2023, generally abroad, medium-term view as we move out of the initial impact of the pandemic. So what we saw post the pandemic, that there was a sort of a deep cut in the GDP growth. It was a minus of 7.3%, and most estimates place it at 9%. The advanced estimate of the government for FY22 is about 9.2% or thereabout. We think that it could be somewhere, this is something somewhat optimistic. I think it could be somewhere around 8.8. But I think a large part of this is largely because of a sort of a low base and a very high growth that we saw in the first quarter. So I think the terminal growth that we're looking at is something like 5.5 kind of a percent, in the last second half of the year. I think it could be in the end towards less than 5%. Going forward, we are looking at something like 8.1, 8.2% for next year. And again, here you have a skew coming from the base effect from the second wave, which will skew up the growth in the first quarter of next year. But again, here the terminal growth is likely to be in the region of 5% or thereabouts. So I think what is emerging out of the pandemic is that the average growth is similar to what it was prior to the pandemic. We were doing 4.5, 5% kind of a growth. I think we will, converge to that kind of a trajectory. Globally, what is projected is that the average growth globally would actually be somewhat lesser, somewhere about 90 basis point lesser than what it used to average prior to the COVID. So I think the overall context for the Indian economy as well is a scenario where global growth is lesser, possibly even from an Indian standpoint. You know, the way I look at it is that, going forward, I think there is a big change in terms of how the dynamics of growth will converge. So essentially, what we are basically looking at is a growth that was earlier driven by rebound in global trade. We know that global trade rebounded by almost like 26% after the shock. So that helped our growth as well. So I think in terms of real GDP, it contributed roughly about 40% of the rebound. The second part that contributed to the recovery was government spending, which was modest, but still it contributed to the recovery. And third part was, of course, the pent-up demand after the lockdown. I think what is going to happen next in the next year or so, the contribution of global trade will actually come off. So we are seeing that global trade volume in terms of mercantile trade is actually contracting from the peak that we saw earlier this year, somewhere around mid of 2021. So there is a contraction of about 2%. So that, I think that support is going to go away. Secondly, from a government spending standpoint, we are seeing certain amount of conservatism. So if you look at the total spending that the central government has done, is roughly about 60% of what was budgeted for the full year till November. So there is a certain amount of conservatism that the government is adopting, possibly because there is slippages as far as public debt to GDP is concerned. We know that government debt to GDP has actually risen to 91%. So I think there is a certain amount of concern on expanding fiscal deficit. We have moved away from FRBM. We are expecting about 6.4% fiscal deficit budgeted for FY23. So there is a significant deviation. So possibly the government is getting more conservative on the fiscal management side. So essentially then the growth will be driven by the private sector consumption demand, the investment demand, and how the banking sector can actually leverage on improvement in sales growth of companies and working capital requirement, etc., and retail lending. So I think the transition will happen from an exogenous factor-driven recovery to endogenous growth recovery, which will be largely determined by the strength of the inherent strength of the private sector, both on the corporate side and the household side.
Okay. So thank you so much for those highlights, Mr. Sinha. So my question to you is specifically about the investments right now. The foreign investors are, quite bullish on the India. We can see the markets are, achieving new highs almost every day, despite the volatility sometimes. GST collections are doing good. Some other positive factors, the indicators, economic indicators are also doing good. And the World Bank has also recently supported the estimated India's growth in a far more positive manner. Considering all these segments, what kind of investments do you see in India, maybe in next 1 or 2 years specifically, or starting from CY 2022?
I think there is a complete dearth of investments in India. I would say if you look at the cycle since, last 10 odd years, I think this is the longest sort of decline in investment cycle that we have seen. There are, from time to time, there are phases where there is very high level of enthusiasm from the private sector, but private capex has been on a decline for a long period of time. More recently, what we have seen is that government has been fairly enthusiastic and they have actually ramped up capital outlay on construction, on railways, etc., which has actually created certain amount of revival. But by and large, the private sector investments has been lacking. So I think the investment to GDP ratio, if you look at the overall context, it has actually been declining from a level of something like 38% to sub 30% over the last 12 years. And that's largely because the investment private capex has actually been lagging. So essentially, there is a very big scope for capex to improve, and it can happen in multiple places. I think at this juncture, I would say that it is still going to take some time. I think as we are emerging from the COVID, what we find is that companies have actually scaled down their employment as well. So manufacturing sector has actually thrown out something like 10 million people out of their employment employment base. And it has been absorbed by agriculture. There is roughly about 4 or 5 million people who have been out of the services space as well. That has been absorbed in the construction space. So I think there is a significant amount of ramp up that needs to first happen by way of employment, job creation, compensation growth, top line growth, and then that translating into better capacity utilization and the capex. Etc. So I think what we will possibly see in the next 1.5 years is a possibility of improving household income and household spending, etc. So the part of the fiscal of the total private sector which you can divide into consumption and capex, the first part, which is the bulk of it, which is the consumption part, which constitute roughly about 60-70% of the GDP, that needs to really ramp up, especially the household spending, which is somewhat lesser. So it's around 55-60%. So that needs to ramp up in a significant way. And there is a possibility of that happening, especially when I would say that when government spending is going to be somewhat lesser and trade is going to be lesser, it will all depend on how private sector in services space, in manufacturing sector ramp up. And the good thing is the services space, especially in IT, related stuff and financial markets or banking sector related employment, I think there is some traction that can have a spillover effect on the rest of the sectors.
Okay. Noted your points, Mr. Sinha. Let me come with a question which is completely different from what I just asked you, and it carries a different implication. So at one side, we have these positive indicators, the global economists and everybody is quite bullish on the growth. On the other side, when you indicated this factor, do you think that we'll take far more longer time to recover and reach to a level, in fact, which we were expecting even after the everything is normal? Because even 2 years back before COVID, it's not that you are growing with a significant numbers. It's not that the corporates or the India Inc. top businesses are investing heavily. It's not that we had a great capex cycle. Right. And now after this speed breaker of 2 years, when the supply chain is broken, when the corporates are absolutely uncertain, do you think that in actual terms will take far more longer time to recover and reach back to where perhaps we were actually?
So I think the way to really answer this question relates to the kind of level of growth and the volatility of growth. So if you look at last 12 years or so, the top line growth of non-finance companies has actually decelerated from 18% to 20% to almost 4 or 5%, let's say 5%. So there has been a sort of a trend decline as far as average sales growth is concerned. So you had multiple macro shocks, including GST. Then you had the demon thing. Then you had the ILFS crisis, and there was NBFC crisis, and there was trade wars in 1991, global trade war, and then you had COVID shocks. So what has really happened is that not just the sales growth is actually decelerated, the volatility in sales growth is also risen. So if you divide the volatility, this is standard deviation in sales growth, and the divided that by the sales, it has actually multiplied 5 times compared to what it used to be, 10 years back. So I think the uncertainty with respect to the outlook on sales is also sort of risen. So not just that you need to have a ramped up sales growth that will come from better employment, better compensation growth, more leverage consumption. You need to, the manufacturing sector will need to see certainty in terms of the top line growth. So your question is right, that it might actually take a little bit more long. It will take longer than usual for people to gain confidence in terms of the sustainability of sales growth. So the way that we are looking at in the interim is that in the interim, the cycle will largely be determined by the strength of household consumption, strength of household income, employment, etc. That will gain far more prominence before major capex happen eventually. So at this juncture, I would say from a banking sector standpoint, let's say that cycle starts emerging 1.5 years down the line. What has happened post the COVID, especially, and it's been happening since the demon shock, is that the formal sector has actually been gaining market share from the informal sector. The small businesses have been impacted adversely, and more so after the COVID. So essentially what you see as sales growth may also be reflecting a significant market share gain for the informal sector. So that is one clear sort of thing that is emerging. So essentially what has happened is that the cash flow for the formal sector has actually increased much dramatically, much strongly. As a result of that, they are paying back debt, there's deleveraging that is happening, etc. So companies might actually continue to have cash flow. Eventually, they need to see utilization and demand going up, and then eventually that they will start demanding lending by way of project lending. So I think that part will still emerge after the initial bit of intent for companies to go ahead and invest in capacities, because they themselves have large cash balances on the balance sheet.
Okay. Valid points, so meaningful one, Mr. Sinha. Let me take your perspective specifically on the banks and finance. In fact, banks and finance companies are holding now. RBI has been also reasonable, and they have supported the stance far more aggressively and always continued with the stance they took almost a year back now. So, but if you look at the capex cycle or specifically the credit demand, it's not there. I mean, not the large corporates, corporates are also not going for a huge demand. So considering all these things, at one side there is enough liquidity, but at the other side there is no demand, how do you see the 2022 shaping up for the banking and the finance company?
So I think what has happened, since the pandemic, is that there was significant scare about NPAs rising because of the impact on businesses and all. So what RBI and government did was to really give a lot of forbearances in terms of recognition of bad assets. So I think there was a more liberal view that was taken. A lot of liquidity was infused. Huge amount of excess liquidity was induced by the RBI through LTRO and TLTRO and other measures, reduction in rates, etc., guarantees, etc., that were given. So all these things have actually ensured that the solvency issues or solvency risk that was being seen by RBI under the stress case scenario, where it thought the NPS could rise by 50%, did not happen. In fact, it has been much better than what was expected. So the NPA ratio for the banking sector in general went down to something like 7.5% in FY21 from 8.5% estimated in FY20. So it's better. I think what is now happening is that the RBI is trying to ring fence the benefit that has emerged because of this by ensuring that the regulatory oversight is good, and they're ensuring that none of the banks go through a sort of create a systemic risk, etc. So we've seen RBI getting more stringent on the regulatory side. Also on the NBFC side, they're having a stronger oversight on NPA recognition, etc. So that's one part of it. The second part in terms of how the businesses will grow. So we know that since the large companies or the organized sector gained a lot from the shock, there is huge amount of cash flow that has happened. They've repaid debt. So if you look at the industry lending, that's roughly about 25% of the total bank lending. There is hardly any growth. Large companies have started becoming positive on a year-on-year basis, but most of the time it was negative. Then on the services side also, there has been a very modest growth of roughly about 1 or 2%. So I think 50%, 55% of the balance sheet of banks are not really growing. So what is really growing is the retail lending by way of mortgage lending and other personal loans on durables, etc. There is some kind of a growth that is happening. So I think going forward also, as we expect the urban sector to revive on the back of better employment, maybe better wages, certain pockets actually doing well. So there can be certain improvement as far as, or more leverage spending that can happen from a household standpoint. So I think a large part of lending will be driven by retail lending. Over a period of time, I would say the working capital from corporate side may also sort of emerge. So I think MSME is something that is actually growing. Maybe there can be some working capital requirement that will happen as the liquidity scenario normalizes. Maybe companies will come back to banks for working capital loans. So it's going to be a very modest kind of a growth. We are looking at lending growth rising to 8 to 10%. We saw it come down to 5.6% in FY21. We're expecting it to be roughly about 8% this year in FY22. We are currently about 7.2%. So there is a gradual improvement that can happen as far as lending business is concerned.
Noted your points. There is one argument which is being always there specifically about the SMEs and MSMEs in the market. And, the one set of argument is that the banks or the NBFCs are not lending enough to the MSMEs and SMEs. The government is also trying its best to support that sector. But do you see that considering the challenges which those sectors are facing, the banks are already, disbursed a lot of funds through TLTRO and different schemes to this MSME and SME sector. That might be also, let me use this word, a dangerous area in terms of delinquencies and NPAs going ahead, because we never know how the situation will be there in the future.
Yeah, I think that's a fair question to ask. Because the thing is that we know that because of these shocks, the relative strength of, or an absolute strength of the MSME small businesses has actually been impacted adversely. So there are certain programs that governments have come up with through guarantees and other things, that there is sort of an increase in lending out there. But I would say that given the state of the economy and the way things can pan out, I think there's a fair chance of NPA emerging there as well. I think various banks and RBI are cognizant about the fact that there is a possibility of the NPA ratios rising and there's vulnerability in the segment.
Right. Now, let me take one or two questions specifically on the budget, Mr. Sinha. So obviously, we are like 2 weeks away from the budget. What do you expect the finance minister will do specifically on the banking and the finance side and also on the economic front? What would be the key highlights according to you?
I think the budget is relatively losing ground in terms of its relevance, I would say, in the overall policy making, because a lot of policies are now being made out of the outside of the budget. So we've seen, especially, I would say since 2000, I would say, since the demon days and thereafter. And then we also saw in 2019 where there was a surprise slump. And then after the COVID shock, a large part of policy making is happening outside of the budget. So I think the relevance of the budget has actually come down significantly if I look back into the history of last 15, 20 years. So I think that is one part. Secondly, I would say the budget would be very relevant from the aggregate numbers standpoint, which will basically tell us what kind of spending the government is willing to do, especially in the current context where we see that the household sector is still under stress by way of employment in salaries and compensation, income flows, etc. So I think government support is definitely still relevant. Also in the private sector, I would say, since the uncertainty level is high, but yet I would say that companies have deleveraged and all, what you require is a sort of a continued support on the demand side, such that there is a sort of a crowding in effect from government spending onto private sector that can happen. And that can happen through better income flow to households, total demand, etc. So I think the relevance of the government spending and the fiscal support is still very much there, I would say. And whether the government adopts a more conservative stance and try to be more stringent on fiscal management and all will need to be seen. As of now, we based on the trend that we are seeing in the spending pattern of this year, we are seeing that government is actually veering towards conservatism. If you look at the data available till now, they have spent only 60% of their budgeted, and it is lesser than 70% for the corresponding periods in the previous 4 or 5 years. And the current levels is equivalent to what it used to be in boom time, which is 2006 and 2008. So I think I would expect governments to be more liberal. It is possible that they might look for a 10% growth in total spending, but it would require 10% would be less than the nominal GDP. I think they will assume something like 12 to 13% nominal GDP. You need to be higher than that. And it might require a certain amount of increased fiscal deficit, but they should allow that to happen. On the banking side, I don't think the budget will have much to do over there. I think what will be relevant is whether there is a recapitalization requirement that is required and all. But I think number will be much lesser because the NPA ratios actually come down. So I think the commitment of the government towards the PSU banks recapitalization could be much, much lesser. We'll also need to see how much bank the budget sort of earmarks for dividends from RBI, for instance, that has been a very major contributor to the revenue side. I think they have been drawing something like 1,95,000 crores last year. I think that's what it was. Whether it's going to be much larger than that, what kind of number will that be? We'll have to see.
Okay. Just a small cross question here. In last maybe 3 to 5 years, government has actually kind of did a lot of things. I mean, most of the reforms or maybe a lot of new rulings in the specifically banking space, they allowed RBI to regulate NBFCs. They, privatized. They are also trying to privatize, two PSU banks. They also merged, amalgamated 2 PSU banks. They also not only just banks, but headed towards insurance companies as well. They want to also privatize 2 general insurance companies. In that front, I'm asking, Mr. Sinha, do you expect some, I won't say a surprise, but maybe some follow on what they have already announced in this PSU, banks or, the insurance companies front?
I don't think much is actually left. So I think as far as the PSU banks consolidation is concerned, I think they did it 2 years back. And I think it has been it is going on. So that process is on. That consolidation is there. I think it is to do with an intent to improve governance, to improve productivity, etc. And so those are the objectives. I think that has been achieved. I think a large part of disinvestment is also happening because they need to have they need to fund the fiscal deficit. And there is a significant rise in the total spending. And I think the average fiscal deficit of state and central put together has more than doubled. So I think there is an imperative that is coming by way of fiscal management that is forcing government to adopt very large disinvestment programs of the order of almost like 2 lakh crores. So I think and I think there will be shortfall there, could be a shortfall there. So they're trying to meet that those targets. I think those things are very much there. I would say I don't see too much of additional sort of effort. I think if they are able to achieve the disinvestment target, that itself will be a big achievement.
Okay, so noted your points. So now my next question is about the private equity. We have seen a great rally towards startups and fintech from the private equity, the foreign investors. Many fintechs have actually raised capital through, hit the stock market, and the market value was far bigger than even the mid-sized banks. So my question to you is, how do you see this rally shaping up in 2022? Will private equity players pour more money into startups? Will more startups, fintech companies hit the stock market? And more importantly, do we have that much scope in capital market for, so many companies which are coming with an IPO?
I think if you look at the fundraising through equity route, I think it has been pretty strong, I would say, over the last few years. I think year to date, I think roughly about 2 lakh crores of fund has been raised through various companies and various types of companies, various through various instruments in the equity market. So I think that is there. I think what we notice is that in the last 1 year, it has been driven significantly by the digitization thing, which is basically, attracting a lot of activities with respect to consumers, retail consumers, in the online space, and fintech companies as well. So because of the digitization, there is a significant ramp up in activities here. So I think there is a huge amount of interest here, and not just in India, I think globally this is happening. So I think this is a structural shift that has happened, especially after the COVID. So I think it is creating a sort of infrastructure or kind of a financial strength within the fintech space, and will have a certain amount of implication for the banking sector, because these entities will have competing businesses with bank, and sometimes it can be supportive as well. So I think there is an additional space in the fintech world that is actually, or in the entire financial space, that is getting added. So I think this is going to be structural. It will imply that banks will have to invest more in technology, and I see a lot of banks doing that. Adoption of technology and digitization in the banking space will gain strength even going forward. I'm not sure whether the momentum is going to be as strong as we have seen, because whenever I would say such events, such shocks happen, it does translate into a lot of activities, and companies are successful in raising money. They make a lot of profit. If I was just looking at all the IPOs that have been announced or sort of fund that's been raised in the public market, I think almost like 78% of them are in profit, and giving a return of almost like 60%. Now there is, I would say, something like 27-28%, which are at a marginal loss on an average basis by about 6-10%. So I think there is a good amount of enthusiasm at this juncture from the retail investors as well, and in the public market. So I think that is what I think. You have a sort of activity level rising on the digitization space, and there is a good amount of retail appetite, that investor appetite that is there. It is possible that there is some absurd valuation that is being quoted or being or price at which where investors have got in or issuance has happened. There can be some normalization going forward in terms of both the pace and the valuation going forward.
Noted your points, I guess, and I'm done with my questions, Mr. Sinha. I took your perspective on budget, obviously, BFSI and investments also. Anything that I missed and you want to add? So thank you so much, Mr. Sinha, for sharing your thoughts at ETBFSI.com. Yeah. Thank you so much.
Thank you for the opportunity. It was nice talking to you.